Hello, hello, my beautiful people. What's up? Man, I have a lot of free time. Not a lot, but, you know, a decent amount. And I've been doing my makeup more in the past, like, month than I've done in, like, all year, to be honest. I was watching the previous video that I uploaded, and I was watching, and I was like, wow, I say like a lot, and I just couldn't believe it. I had to be like, I'm saying it again, oh, my enemies have suffered. I was just so annoyed with myself watching that video, I think I'm going to be editing it out, and I just need to not be lazy and edit it out. Because I think it takes away from what I'm saying when you hear like after every, like, sentence. Oh. My mom always warned me. She said if I get into the habit of saying, you know, y'all, things like that, it's going to be hard to let go of and hard to, like, unlearn. And boy, was she right, because look at me now. I want to be more aware of what I say and minimizing the amount of times I say like, because it's unnecessary. I had a really fun time on Saturday. So I actually worked on Saturday. We had a plastics lab, and you know, I was initially gonna take my MCAT that Saturday, but I actually decided not to because I just did not have the, I've already taken the MCAT. I just wanna put that out there. I've already taken the MCAT. And I walked out of that exam feeling like shit, to be honest. And I said, oh my goodness, like, this score cannot be good. I didn't feel good coming out of the testing room. It was a very hard exam. I shed a thug tear. I've worked so hard and spent, like, all year studying, and to walk out the exam room feeling terrible, feeling like I bombed this exam was a terrible feeling to have. And I was very sad for a while. And I was so sad that I just was like, I don't even know what my score is, but I'm just going to register to take the exam again, because better to be safe than sorry. So I had done that, and work started ramping up, and like school was ending with my finals, and I just did not have time or the bandwidth to study as well as I want to make sure I do better. Because the worst thing you can do is take the MCAT again and then do worse. Like, it's just like one of those things you don't want to happen to you. And I had to sit down and make a decision. I said, Shaun, you're working so much overtime. You come home late. Your schedule is very unpredictable this month. And every day matters in studying for the MCAT. So I said, you know what? I'm not going to take it. But I only said this after I got my score back, of course. Like, I didn't make this decision before getting my score back. I looked at my score, and I thought it was good enough. I was satisfied with the score because I know where I started. And where I started, ooh, y'all. The score I started with, it did not have a fighting chance. The score I started with, it did not have a fighting. I wouldn't even pass any screenings, honestly. The score that, like, my diagnosis, it was bad. And I know how many nights I stayed at work after work just to study. I know how I managed my time to still do well in school and study for the MCAT. And I know how hard I worked, and the score I got is what I worked for, you know, and that's what months of studying looked like for me. And I was like, you know what? I'm gonna run with it, and I don't think it's a bad score. Should I use the word competitive? Well, it depends on the school you apply to. I thought it was a good enough score for me, and knowing where I come from, so I said, you know what? As much as I do want to take the I don't want to take the MCAT again. Let me clarify that. You do not want to take that exam more than once. I promise you, you don't want to do that to yourself. But I did feel like I could possibly do better, you know? But the timing, I just did not have time, and I did not feel comfortable going into an exam that I did not adequately study for and make sure that I was going to make a difference from the score I had before. And I remember I met with one of my faculty, and I told him my score, and he was like, But you know, he's also He also works at Stanford. So Stanford's looking for like 95th percentile. And he was like, yeah, what, like, take it again. And I said, I don't have time to study. He's like, did you take notes when you were studying before? I was like, yeah. He was, and then he said, well, review your notes and then take it. I think you can increase your score by like 10 points. And I looked at him, I said, I studied for months for the score I got, and you want me to review my notes in 2 days, and you think I can increase by 10 points? That, see, you need to have those kind of advisors. You need to have those kind of, you need to have mentors that have that kind of faith in you. The fact that he had that kind of faith in me, and I don't even have that in myself, tells you he is a good mentor. I don't think he gave some good advice, but he's a good mentor for him to, like, have such faith and confidence in me. I'm not gonna risk it, so I was like, I'm going to respect myself and not retake the exam. But it's good to have people who really, who see such potential in you. And I was like, wow, I would have never, you would have never been my mentor if I didn't take that leap of faith and just reach out to you. You know, this was my senior, he was my human physiology professor, and it was my senior year. And of course, you know, I'm trying to get an A in his class because I need it. I needed the A. And I wanted to meet with him to figure out, well, how has other students in your class been successful? And how did they, you know, do well? What were the things that you saw them do that made them very successful? And that's what I wanted to get from him, right? My senior year, I started every class reaching out to professor saying, I want to do well in your class. And I want to know what other people did and what your suggestions are for how I can succeed in your classroom. And that's how that mentorship started. And, you know, he's really taken me under his wing, and he's been so invested in seeing my progress, seeing my growth, seeing me get to my final destination. And it feels so good to have those kind of people in your corner. I thought to myself, asking for help is a very powerful tool that we all have at our disposal. And nothing bad can come from asking for help, for the most part, in my opinion. I started reflecting. I was looking at all the situations in which I've been in, and the times I've asked for help, and the times that I have not asked for help. So, for example, when I was in chemistry, general chemistry, my freshman year, I knew damn well I did not know what was going on in class. I did not understand moles. I did not understand pH. I, like, didn't understand what I was doing in lab. Like, I knew I didn't know anything, and I thought it would fix itself magically, and I didn't ask for help, and I didn't, you know, reach out to go to office hours or talk to the professor or any of that stuff. And of course, we all know how that turned out for me. I got a C. I got multiple C's. When I look at the times, like when I decided to get back into pre-med, and I look at the times, like I look at biology and I saw that I did not do well my fall quarter, I said something has to change, and I reached out to people. I was really, really afraid because my freshman year, I don't think I've actually mentioned this, but my freshman year, I actually did go to a resource once for help, and it just wasn't a good experience, and I never went back again, and that's what, you know, deterred me from going to ask for help. I knew about academic skill coaching my freshman year, and I went to one session with someone, and it didn't feel right. I didn't feel like I got anything from that, you know, session, and I just didn't feel good, so I never returned. I said, okay, well, this resource is not for me because this first impression did not go well for me. I didn't go back until my junior year. Of course, you know, I reaped the consequences of that, but I did try, and it had me thinking of, like, wow, there are certain people who do try to go out and reach for help, but that one thing that deters them, and they never go back, or they feel like, you know, this person can't help me because they don't understand me, or they don't understand my situation, and like, or they're making these false assumptions. I remember my junior year when I decided I wanted to go back into pre-med classes. I went to a pre-med advisor, and after this meeting, I never went back to her again. But I was adamant about, you know, going back in, and I was gonna do these classes, I was gonna do well, I was gonna kill it. I was adamant. I was like, you can't stop me. And literally, she looked at my GPA. I can't make this up. I really cannot make this up, and I have no reason to, because I would not want this to happen to me or anyone else. She looked at my GPA, and I know my GPA wasn't that great, but it was as if she didn't see any hope for me to become a doctor by looking at my GPA. She was like, honestly, I felt like she wanted to discourage me from taking classes at Stanford, because she looked at my GPA and was like, you don't have a track record of doing well here, like, maybe you should do a post-bac, or maybe you should do these classes somewhere else. And I was like, dang, girl, you're not going to even give me a chance, or, like, you know, at least try to support me in trying to finish the classes here. I think she assumed that my grades were not that great because I was doing all these other stuff, and I was hanging out with friends and doing all this stuff, because she made one comment. She said, you know, if you really want to, you know, start doing well, you're going to have to stop hanging out with friends and, you know, can't go out to ice cream, all this stuff. And I'm just like, who told you I was even going out with friends? Because to be honest, at that point in time when I met up with her, I was not going out that much. I did not really have friends. Like, to be honest, okay, I had my line sisters, so those were my friends. But, like, I really didn't have friends, so there was nowhere for me to go. So I know it wasn't because I was being too social. And it was so it was just so frustrating to hear her say that. And it was so frustrating for her to, like, to feel like she was just lumping me in with, you know, all these other people. And at this point, luckily for me, this was my junior year. At this point, I had enough self-confidence and self-assurance in myself that I actually stopped her. I said, ma'am, look, I am going to be a doctor. Point blank, period. There's nothing you, my enemies, the devil, the president of Stanford himself can say that will not make me a doctor. Period. And I'm here because I need you to help me get there. I need some advising. I need to figure out what I need to do to get there. I didn't ask you to discourage me. I didn't ask you to start making all these assumptions. I just need you to help me. And that's what I'm here for. And it wasn't until I put my foot down and really advocated for myself that all of a sudden she was Team Shown. Now, it's not hard for me to get you on Team Shown, but it was like, why did I have to stop you and advocate for myself for you to automatically be on my team? If I am going to advising, the moment I walk into your room, you should be on my team because you're here to help the students, you know, and give them realistic advice. And I think I understand you have to be realistic with yourself, and there's certain times where you have to triage and say, all right, something is not working. Because I remember, my junior year, I wanted to apply to this pre-med summer program to start, like, building my resume and start trying to pick back the pieces of my life, honestly. And I needed a recommendation from a science professor. Mind you guys, at this time, I had not done well in any single science class. I had not made connections with professors. I didn't know anyone, and no one knew me. And all I knew was my bio TA, and she was Black. And I said, hey girl, do you think you could write me my recommendation? Like, you know, my recommendation, since you're technically my TA. And she was like, I can write an addendum to a professor, but I cannot write for you. And then that opened the whole conversation of, like, I had to admit to her and say, hey, I don't have anyone that can vouch for me. I don't have any faculty that could write me a recommendation at all. And of course, you know, I think she shared that with people with faculty in the department. And eventually I got connected to the director of the human biology program. And I was told, just go and meet with him. He kind of, you know, he already knows the background of your situation. Just go meet with him and see what happens. So I said, you know what, at this point, it can't even hurt to go meet with him. And I met with him, and we talked a little bit, and I explained to him my situation. I said, you know, while I'm, like, not really doing well in school, but I'm trying to get my life together. And he made this analogy, you know, and this was in regards, and I want to highlight something, because the way he made the analogy was very different from the way the pre-med advisor approached me or spoke to me. He said, because he's a neurosurgeon, so he said, if I'm working on the brain and I'm doing surgery on the brain, and then the patient I'm working on gets internal bleeding in their stomach, do I continue operating on their brain, or do I stop the bleeding that's currently happening? And basically, he was trying to say the ultimate goal for, like, in this medical analogy, is to complete the surgery and have, you know, whatever needs to be done in the brain be done in the brain. However, once an obstacle pops up, you don't ignore that obstacle. You know, you address the obstacle, then get back to your bigger goal. And he was saying, look, I hear you. I see what's happening. I see that, you know, you're struggling in school. And the struggle in the school right now may be the obstacle. It may be the internal bleeding. And the ultimate goal is to get into medical school. The ultimate goal is to achieve that goal. But you have to stop the bleeding right now. You need to figure out whether this means I need to stop. I need to know when to stop and just take a post back. Or evaluate, is this something I can fix, you know, right now? And the way it was said to me was, I received a lot better because it was in a different way. It wasn't in this kind of like dismissive way of, yeah, you're just gonna have to take a post back because you have no hope of doing well here. And there were even friends who suggested I should just do the post back. And I said no. I was very adamant. I said, I'm going to get it done. And back to the original story. So after he told me that analogy, you know, he offered to write me the letter of recommendation that I needed for that pre-med summer program. And this man did not know me from Adam. He didn't know me anywhere. That was the one time we met, and he was already willing to write me a letter of recommendation. And I felt so honored, and I felt like, finally, like, there are people who are believing in me and people who want to see me succeed, you know, want to see me succeed. And that is when I really realized the power of asking for help. And that's when I realized, wow, like, if I never said anything to my TA, I would have never met this faculty who has now become my advisor, who is now my mentor, who, like, wants to see me win. Like, if I didn't say anything, if I didn't ask for help, this would have never happened. Like, this would have never happened. And at the end of the day, I did not get the summer program because y'all know my GPA was trash, but it started something new and a lot bigger for me. I saw the value in reaching out to faculty and getting mentors and being able to extend that hand and say, hey, I need help, I need assistance, I'm trying to get somewhere, can you help me? And the idea is that people who are already there, someone helped them, right? So they have to pay it forward by helping other people. And since then, I told myself, okay, one bad experience with a pre-med advisor or academic skill coach or like whatever it is, like one experience that did not feel good to me should not mean I dismiss the whole resource away, or it should mean that I can't utilize it anymore. And that's when I said, okay, I didn't like working with this person in the pre-med advising, let me try someone else, as opposed to writing off the whole department. Let me try someone else. And I tried another pre-med advisor and I liked her a lot better, and I found that she was a lot more supportive and a lot more, you know, I think she had some hesitation, and she, you know, she had to squint her eyes a bit when, you know, I told her I was going to turn my grades around. I think she had some doubt, but, like, I came back to her after my fall quarter senior year, and she was like, wow, you said it, and you did it. And I did the damn thing, all right? I did the damn thing. And I tried again with academic skill coaching. I said, okay, I didn't necessarily like this experience. Let me try a different person. And I found the person that works for me. And I was like, wow, this is a good fit. And this is the person I want to continue seeing until I get my life together and figure out how to do well in school. And I want to say that because I think as pre-meds or as minority students or students of color, it is a lot harder to utilize resources at our school for multiple reasons, right? Because most of the people in these positions may not understand where we're coming from, may not understand our academic background, do not necessarily understand where our struggles come from. And we automatically feel discouraged by certain instances where they tell you you're not cut out to be a doctor, or, you know, to be a doctor you have to have a 4.0, X, Y, and Z, X, Y, and Z, X, Y, and Z. And that pushes you away and you never ask for the help you need. And that's really sad. And one thing I tell my friends and I tell people when I talk to them or encourage them or give them advice, I say, do not be afraid to use resources. You are paying to be at this school, so why would you not use the resources? Why would you not utilize the things on campus that your money is going towards, whether you use it or not? So you might as well just use it, honestly. You might as well just use it, because you're already paying for it, whether you like it or not. You're paying for it, so just do it. And this is a testimony, y'all. Finding the person I actually like to work with, I, you know, was telling her how I was struggling studying for the MCAT, and I didn't necessarily have a sense of direction. I didn't understand how to study. I also had a lot of content to review, partially because some classes I just didn't do well in. So literally it was like learning from scratch. And, you know, I was sharing with her how I was struggling, and like she offered, well, why don't you take a prep class? And I said, girl, I'm already paying out of state tuition for a school at a community college, and I'm not even making that much money. Like, I'm working. I don't have the financial resources to take a preparatory class. And after I said that to her, she goes, into her desk and pulls out the certificate for a free Kaplan MCAT course. And she said, I've been waiting on the right student to give this to, a student who I think is really needing of it, really deserving, a student who I see can use it to the its highest potential, and I want to give it to you. And I was so touched. And telling her my struggles and telling her how, I needed help with this one thing, I was able to get a free Kaplan course to study for my MCAT. All because I asked for help. All because I said something, as opposed to suffering in silence. And those courses go for about two plus grand. Like, that's a lot of money. And I got it for free, 99. It just goes to show you that it never hurts to ask for help. You never know, and who you're talking to can be your helper, can who can take you to the next level. And this is something my dad always tells me. He always tells me, you have to be nice to people, whether you know them or not, because you never know who's gonna lend you a helping hand in the future. And if you were rude to someone, or if you were mean to someone, or if you were just not nice to someone in the past, they're gonna remember that. And when it's time for you, when you need that help, they may not offer you that help because they remember something you said or did to them. And that's why it's so important to just always be nice to people, and always just be your best self no matter where you are, because you never know who is who. And there are times that people try your patience. Like, when I'm driving, there just be some people, and I say, how do you drive like this? What is wrong with you? Like, what is troubling your soul? Why are you driving like a crackhead on the road? And I guess so sometimes, or like if something happens in the store, and I just say, why did you do this? I try to remind myself, you never know who is who. You never know who can help you tomorrow. Just always, always be kind. Be kind to yourself and be kind to everyone else.